And so our speaker tonight is Ron Adams. Ron graduated from the Naval Academy in 1981, and he's been studying and applying his knowledge about energy production ever since that graduation date. He served as the engineering officer of a nuclear-powered submarine. Were you the engineering officer of two submarines?
I was an engineering officer on the first one and the engineering officer on the second one.
He founded a small company to design and market small nuclear powered engines. He served as an analyst on the staffs of the Secretary of the Navy and the Chief of Naval Operations. And he's worked on the development team for a leading small modular reactor company. Now, he didn't say which one it was, but it's revealed down below here. In 1995, he began publishing Atomic Insights. How many people here know about Atomic Insights? 15.
They're at the table.
Atomic Insights as a means of sharing nuclear knowledge with a public that needs access to information that commercial media rarely understands or covers. In 2006, he began producing and hosting the Atomic Show podcast as one more venue for sharing his passion for clean, abundant energy. Rod retired from the U.S. Navy as a commander in September of 2010 after several years of employment on the B&W M-Power reactor development team. He decided to become a full-time writer, publisher, and atomic energy educator. Rod earned a B.S. in, now wait, it must be a B.A. in English.
B.S.
in English, Bachelor of Science in English. I haven't heard of that before. I don't think anybody else here has either. So I'm putting it down right here. And that was from the Naval Academy, and then an MS in Systems Technology from Naval Postgraduate School, and he also holds a Naval War College Diploma in Nuclear Strategy and Policy. I wish you to welcome a War College Diploma in National, not Nuclear Strategy, but National. Yeah, he said earlier that he only wanted to get, the closest weapon he wanted to get to was a pistol, and then I told him that I'd been testing nuclear bombs when I was in Nevada, and so then he moved over closer to Wanda. I want you to welcome then Rod Adams. Come on.
The only experimental data that the committee had accessible to them. assumptions. And they admitted they had a lot of assumptions. And then many of the benefits that we should have been withheld. So the question is, you know, and of course we've been, the nuclear professionals have been trying to overcome this fear for a very long time, but there's been a large opposition to that overcoming. People do appear to be afraid, and they keep going back to a statement that was part of this initial assumption. It's called that there is no safe dose. Again, even though radiation has been a natural part of our environment since forever. And a lot of people will point back and say, you know, people overcame their fear of fire because it was useful. But one of the things that, that many don't point out about fire is that fire has some immediate negative effects that cause people to recognize it's something to be afraid of. If you put your hand in fire, it burns. If you stand next to a fire, you get the smoke and start coughing. If you try to bring it indoors, it does bad things. So it wasn't hard for people to recognize that they needed to fear fire until they could understand how to control it and keep it under control and use it as a tool. Okay, so I think that there's a complete contrast between that kind of natural fear caused by the fact that there's pain involved and the fear of radiation, because at the doses that people were exposed to initially, there was no visible effect. They could see through things, they could take pictures and photographs of hands, but nobody was getting hurt. It was only until they started isolating various radioactive materials and concentrating it, or until they figured out how to make them artificially with X-ray machines, that people were able to create a high enough dose to cause any pain at all. And the first thing that they noticed was skin erythema, and then that came at relatively high doses from our point of view today. Okay, so there was no immediate visible negative effect, so people didn't fear it. It was something that they accepted, and they also got excited about it. People started finding out new things to do with this radiation. They started using it to treat medical conditions. They recognized that it could be used, if you had a high enough dose, you could start attacking tumors with it. People said, hey, if we, you know, this radiation appears to be what always attracted us to places that have warm water, the springs. We recognized that there was material in there that, that was from the radioactive. And people had, by folklore, recognized that these warm springs had medicinal effects. So again, it was something that they were kind of excited about. It was, you know, people that started making radioactive concoctions and selling them as patent medicine. It's a thing called radiofluor, where people put X-ray machines in shoe shops and let you take a picture of your feet so you get a better fit for your shoes. Okay, it wasn't something people were afraid of. And matter of fact, one of the materials that Marie Curie isolated, radium, became what has to have been the most valuable substance known to man, because it sold in 1920 for $120,000, 1920s dollars, per gram, okay? Because of its properties of being radioactive, because it was the most intense radioactive source from a natural material they could find, okay? And still is the most radioactive naturally occurring substance. But it was a valuable substance. It wasn't something to be afraid of. Marie Curie, the discoverer, the person who isolated radium, didn't have any radium of her own. And she had was invited to the United States in 1920 for a grand tour where she was spoke at many women's colleges around the country, had a meeting in Carnegie Hall with 3,500 representatives of women's colleges. I can't remember the name of the acronym, but they gave her, as part of, you know, the reward for having spent all the effort touring the U.S., they gave her a gram of uranium. Graham was ready to take back with him, you know, worth $120,000. He thought that was really special. Okay. Now, here's the part of the story that, is difficult to tell, especially when you like to be considered a very serious person. You don't want people to dismiss you as some sort of wild conspiracy theorist or whatnot. But as an English major, and I do have a Bachelor of Science in English, okay, a BS in BS, and I got that because I took enough math and science and engineering courses as part of my requirement to be a graduate of the Naval Academy that they gave a science degree, vice a English degree. It took 30 hours of English and 120 hours of other stuff. But here's a story that, I'm going to try to tell you and, hope you guys understand it and recognize that it's important to understand why people do things. The motivation in human activity is something worth studying. It's something that we studied a lot as a literature major. When we were learning how to analyze literature and to write novels of our own, or write creative works of our own, the instructors were always banging on us. You got to figure out why people do things. And if you're going to make an action in a story, you can't let the person just do it out of the blue and have no motivation or, you know, it's no backstory or nothing that says, hey, that's why this person ended up deciding to, you know, run off to, join the Navy. You know, you had problems with his dad. You know, whatever it is, you had to have a motivation. So here's a truth. Okay, Hermann Muller was a genetics researcher, and in the 1920s, he was doing his work on Drosophila at the University of Texas under a grant from the Rockefeller Foundation. In 1927, he published his work on the radiation effects or causing mutations with X-rays. The lowest dose that he used in his studies was 400 R, okay? And if you want to, you know, use sieverts, you can say that that is 4 sieverts, okay? 400 R. So that's what the lowest dose he exposed his fruit flies to in an experiment. And somehow, he came up, and by the time he was awarded his Nobel Prize, which was 1956, he said that his experiments leave no escape from the conclusion that there is no threshold dose, that all the way down to zero dose, there would be an effect, and it would be because of this individual hits called the target theory. Okay? Now, again, I want to help try to lay the background for this, try to figure out how this LNT got established. And hopefully you all know some of the assumptions or the, some of the results of the LNT that come out. It says that all doses are cumulative. Okay, so if you've got any dose at all, you just keep adding it up and, keep adding to your risk. It also says that doses are collective. In other words, if you come up with the slope of the linear line, you can't use that number and apply it to any dose, no matter how many people receive that dose. So if you have a fatal dose might be 2,000 rem or 20 sieverts, okay? If you then split that dose up over 100 people, you still get one death. If you split it up over many people, you still get one death. Even though when you start looking at the numbers, nobody's exposed to anything that could cause harm or can even be measurable, okay? So that's what the equivalent assumptions are. So in 1954, the National Committee on Radiation Protection and the International Committee on Radiation Protection had come up with a notion based on a whole bunch of observations of human effects of animal studies done during the Manhattan Project and soon after World War II, and they came together, the the scientists from the U.S., the U.K., and Canada met, and they issued a report called the Tripartite Report that accumulated all the observations they had on the actual effects, health effects, from the radiation that they'd seen. And of course, we had by that time 60 years worth of experience of what the effects of radiation were. And some of those studies were long and followed people down a long time. And so that report said that the right limit was 15 rem, that's 150 millisieverts, okay? That was issued in 1954. In 1953, the USS Nautilus prototype started operating, producing reliable power, and the Nautilus was under construction. The shipping port reactor was under construction. Eisenhower had announced his Atoms for Peace program. The UK was building Calder Hall and planning to produce commercial electricity, and there was a lot of excitement being covered by publications like the New York Times and Time magazine about the interests that industrial concerns, particularly Westinghouse and GE, had to develop commercial atomic power plants and make power that didn't burn any fossil fuels. Okay? In 1954, again, that happened in the 50s, those things were all happening. In 1954, the Rockefeller Foundation Board of Trustees met, and this is recorded in a biography of Warren Weaver, it's published by the National Academy of Sciences, so it's pretty reliable, and said to the National Academy of Sciences, can you guys do anything to resolve the public confusion about the health effects of radiation? They, according to this biography, they read in newspapers that people were not sure who to believe, which experts to believe. So they said to the NAS, we want you guys to do a study. The NAS picked six committees, but this was the committee that actually produced part of the study that caused people to be the most afraid, the genetic subcommittee. It was headed by Warren Weaver as the chairman. Of those 16 names on there, eight of them were Rockefeller Foundation grantees. Herman Muller, Miroslav Demirek, Crow, Beadle, Neal, Sertaban, Shields Warren, they were all Rockefeller Foundation grantees. Warren Weaver, who worked for the Rockefeller Foundation, had a very interesting job. He was the head of their biological and genetics program. Every grant that the Rockefeller Foundation gave for those two topics from 1932 to 1958 was approved, reviewed by Warren Weaver. He held the checkbook. Now he's the committee chairman of the BEAR committee. BEAR committee. Okay? So, after all this excitement people had about the coming atomic age, the fact that we were going to have a new source of energy, we're going to be able to use less coal and oil and natural gas, this committee issued a report called the Biological Effects of Atomic Radiation, and the Genetics Committee asserted the linear no threshold dose assumption for genetic effects. Note, they didn't say a word about cancer at this particular time. They said, based on what we know about genetics, there is no minimum amount of radiation which must be seen before mutations occur. Any amount, however small, that can cause a corresponding small number of mutations, the more dose, the more mutations. And they were very concerned about the effects that this coming atomic age were going to have on the human genome. They didn't call it that back then. They said something about the gene pool, I believe. Harm is cumulative, genetic damage, and so they wrote this report and tried to make people very afraid and told them that they recommended a dose limit of 10 R for all the period of time before you stop being reproductive. So for the first 40 years of life, they wanted you to accumulate no more than 10 R, whereas the national Committee on Radiation Protection, the International Committee on Radiation Protection, composed of people who actually practice with radiation, said 15 R per year. Okay? The reports that these guys issued was published. I mean, the entire Beer report, all six committees, was the full text of it was published in the New York Times the next day. New York Times wrote a bunch of headline articles, and on page one, the right-hand column, you know, the first one that you see when you open the paper, said radiation peril. On again, people weren't afraid of radiation before this report was issued and the publicity began. Okay? LNT, Begat, Alara, as low as any amount of radiation can kill you, you gotta minimize the risk. The other piece of Alara that comes out, and the other piece of no safe dose, turns into something that is an ethical thing that prevents research. Because if there's no safe dose, you can't ethically use radiation on human beings purposely and measure what the effect is. You can't get volunteers to do a test because you already know, it's assumed, that it's dangerous, right? You can do efficacy tests on new drugs because you don't know yet what the effect is. But you can't do efficacy tests on radiation, even though it has many potential treatment beneficial effects. Okay? Alara also says that the limitation on radiation is not based on a fixed limit. It's based on how low can you go? How low can you detect? Okay? Because the better you are at detecting, the better you've got to be at preventing doses. It just increases fear. One of the things I want to help engineers, nuclear people understand is many times if you respond to people's expression that they're afraid of something by designing more and more layers, by designing more and more protections, you know what the effect that you've had on that person is? You tell them that you're really afraid too. If you're going to go to all that trouble to make all these systems and say, well, look at all these things that we do to protect you, they say, wow, you guys are really afraid of this stuff. I should be afraid too. Okay. These guys, they, you know, if you read in certain parts of the internet, there's all kinds of weird people out there and publish weird things, but Counterpunch is an organization that is, or publication that really emphasizes this no safe dose stuff. And they're always pointing out, hey, it's X number of times the normal dose. Well, there is no normal amount of cesium-137 in the environment, right? The only cesium-137 that's out there has always been produced by mankind. Okay, so, and if the only cesium-137 was left over from bomb testing, the normal amounts are very low. So if you say, hey, it's 30 times normal, okay, how does it compare to potassium-41 or some other naturally occurring? Now, I kind of borrowed, I'm going to give credit where it's due on these slides, because these aren't all my slides. I borrowed some of these slides from other people. But this one here is interesting because JFK is correct for most myths. But I believe that there are some myths that are purposely created to control people, to advance a certain agenda, or, quite frankly, to make money. Okay? So sometimes the myths can be created, and there are people who are very good, very skilled at propaganda. Now, you know, those of us who live now after World War II always think of propaganda as something governments do. But there was a guy named Edward Bernays who wrote a book called Propaganda, I think 1926 or something. And the big readers of propaganda by Edward Bernays were Madmen, right? The advertisers, the people that really want to find out ways to get the public to do things that the public really shouldn't be doing, but it makes money, so they want them to do it, like smoking cigarettes or whatever, right? Okay, so propaganda is a way to convince people of what you want them to believe, whether or not it's the truth. Okay? And so I believe we're holding fast to the myth that all radiation is dangerous because there's been a purposeful creation of that myth. One of the guys has done a lot of research on what the real effects of all kinds of substances are is Ed Calabrese. He's a toxicologist who's been working for many years in the field of the dose response. He started researching dose response when he was a student and recognized that I think he was given an experiment where they were supposed to use a chemical that was a herbicide, and they were to demonstrate the results of the herbicide by following the plant life over time. Well, he goofed. When he mixed the herbicide, he was off by a factor of 10. So he gave his plants a dose of herbicide that was 1/10 what it was supposed to be, and his plants flourished. So after that goofy experiment, that mistake, he started studying more about dose response and realized that many things that we are told are toxic because they have effects at very high doses, when they're down at low doses and moderate doses, they actually have a stimulation effect. Now, the effect is not always very big. Sometimes it's in the 10 to 20, maximum of about 30% range, but it's there. And he's done studies over all kinds of topics. As it says here, his CV is 145 pages long. He's published a lot. And he has an interesting background in that he started his career as an academic in history, and says he's always had the history bug, but he's done mostly technical stuff through his formal studies after he changed majors as a junior. Okay, he published a story of how Herman Muller actually misled people. Because one of the things that I didn't mention was when Herman Muller made his talk in 1946 to accept the Nobel Prize, and it's interesting how he got the Nobel Prize in 1946, because he was really a disgraced scientist from the time of about 1932 through 1946. The only job he could get during World War II was at Amherst College as a teacher. But that aside, before he gave his talk, he was in his hands, and he'd already reviewed it because he acknowledged receipt and acknowledged some comments on the paper. He had in his hands a paper by one of his proteges that showed that the fruit fly experiment for mutations, once you got to a real low dose, effects disappeared. There were no measurable effects. Matter of fact, it showed that the threshold dose existed. But he didn't want to say that to people when he talked to them in 1946. Again, Muller was already a Rockefeller Foundation grantee well before that. So he promoted the LNT even though he knew contrary evidence, and his colleagues helped cover it up. And again, it allowed the National Academy to adopt it. You know, we've got some studies. One of the best studies that falsifies the LNT is a nuclear shipyard worker study. Now, this study matched very closely the controlled and non-controlled group. There was no healthy worker effect because the controls were also workers in the same shipyard. They had the same health benefits, the same health screenings to become non-nuclear workers. They worked in the same shipyard. They were exposed to the same. Everything was the same except one group was exposed to radiation and one group wasn't. And it turns out that the people that were exposed to the carbon-60 doses actually had better health, long-term health. They had lower cancer rates, lower mortality rates, and a lower death rate finding. But the study, paid for by the DOE to identify if there's any problems, never got fully published because, hey, it didn't show any problems. The National Academy said that The occupational has uncertainty in risk estimates, kind of implying that there's uncertainty in the doses and the health follow-up. Well, as a former engineer officer and a former chemistry and radiological control systems, I can testify to the detail with which doses were measured and recorded on Navy ships, and the importance that our bosses held to that recording and the accuracy with which those recordings were maintained and historical records were kept. The stuff is good, particularly compared to the dose reconstructions used in the studies on the atomic bomb survivors. You know, when you think about, on one side you've got people who are wearing dosimeters all the time, and they get those measured once a week, and then all this recording. On the other side, you've got people who are exposed to radiation, and the doses were reconstructed based on the distance from the bomb, based on their memory 5 years after the bomb was dropped, where they thought that they were, and nobody remembered how many buildings there were in between them. So I'm not sure how they got the doses on those. Jerry Cutler's a guy who's been really pushing on this fact of we need to use real science to identify for people what the effects of radiation are, not assumed science. We need to use data and observe measurements and those kinds of things, not assumptions. And one of the things that people are recognizing is that as we get better at detecting things, we get to see more and more exactly what happens to genetic material as it's exposed to radiation and what happens afterwards, how the repair functions work and how well they work, because they're part of our evolution. They really have been a protected part of our evolution, that we get exposed to radiation at certain levels and our cells repair any damage, and they do it well. There's none of this, well, the repair may not be correct. Well, no, these aren't bad carpenters. These are natural carpenters, and I'm not sure, but some people would say God's carpenters. Okay, so the repairs are very good as long as the repair mechanisms aren't overwhelmed, as long as the doses are in the moderate range. Okay, here's a curve showing the lower than relative relative risk, much below one for mice. It actually helps to cure cancer. By the way, some of you who read Atomic Insights may recognize Jerry's name. I quote him a lot, and I write articles about him. But one of the things that Jerry shared with me is that his wife had some, I'm not sure exactly what the medical condition was, but the treatment that the other doctors recommended was something that she just didn't want to accept. Jerry, working with a Japanese scientist who's been studying this area for a long time, recommended a low-dose regimen where she came in once a week and got a dose of 150 millisieverts, so 15 rem, every week for 10 weeks. Never saw any negative effects, no side effects, but her condition was eliminated based on the low dose effect. So Jerry didn't need it. He would have taken it if he did, and he has also, you know, gone and exposed himself on purpose at radon spas and that kind of stuff. But when his wife needed treatment, he recommended it, she accepted it, and she's very happy. It's not just Indigo, there are others that have done the same. So there's mice, dogs. I'm sorry. The roller wheel is a little bit sensitive. All right. So adaptive responses, and radiation is a stimulant of adaptive responses. It activates natural protective mechanisms. It is, in fact, an antioxidant. Because one of the things that damages DNA on a regular basis is the oxidation process itself. Free radicals go in and cause about 10 to 20,000 strand breaks every day. Radiation at 100 millisieverts per year causes about 12 strand breaks. Even if you look at the double strand breaks, natural oxidation is about 1,000 times more strand breaks than you get with 100 millisieverts of radiation. And the radiation seems to increase the protective mechanisms. And to me, as you know, over time, I'm not quite as much as I used to be, but I was an athlete, recognized that many things that are good for you at moderate levels can be very painful at too high a level. And if you don't have them at all, it's really bad because you get, you know, your body stops being able to respond to things. You got to have the right dose, the right level of things. That seems to be true for vitamins, because many of the things we take as vitamins could be toxic at high levels. And this has been known for a long time, that the dose makes the poison. This is another presentation that I borrowed with permission from Dr. Bobby Scott. I'm going to go through these fairly quickly so I can get time for questions. But Dr. Scott was part of a very interesting program, and I know that I'm talking to people that have probably had this experience or have seen people have this experience. He was part of a program that was going along very well and suddenly got defunded. People got out of work, and Bobby, as he told me, he retired earlier than planned, and many of his colleagues who are working in the same area also have either had to go look for other work or retired. And the program he was part of was called the Department of Energy's Low Dose Radiation Program. They actually decided that it would be a good idea to find out what low dose effects really are. And they funded a number of studies over a period of about 8 years, between 2000 and 2009, 2010 or so, I guess maybe 10 years, was when they gave their last grants, and then all the funding was taken away and it was gone by the end of 2012. The program wasn't over, there was no final reports produced. It just got defunded. I still haven't figured out why or who, but I continue to pull the string on that. So here's the risk implication of the LNT model. Any amount of radiation causes cancers. Doubling the amount of radiation causes, you know, doubles the amount of cancers, and it doesn't matter how big you spread it. And of course, you know, these calculations led to people saying, hey, well, hundreds of thousands of people from Chernobyl. Even when people say, well, really, the number is about 4,000, the 4,000 number still uses the LNT. Okay, and it's still an assumption that has not been proven by experience. There are no excess cancers from Chernobyl. There were 28 people that were killed because of exposure to fire or acute radiation syndrome. And there were a number of people that had thyroid cancers that were attributed to the event, and of those, about 15 people passed away. And there's a lot of evidence that says that we don't know what the natural rate of thyroid cancers were in that area because nobody ever screened for it before. And it was an area where there's a known deficiency of iodine in the diet. Okay, so these are some of the things that you do with the LNT-based production. Now, Floyd mentioned that I have a master's degree in systems technology. I'm not a biologist, I'm not a chemist, but I like systems and system thinking and recognize that feedback loops and all that stuff that we engineer into things, we kind of copy from biological systems. We recognize that there are feedbacks, there are responses, and that if you have, as long as your system isn't overloaded, you can get it so it produces a stable response. So a systems radiation biology, or system radiation biology, is different from the molecular biology that the geneticists tried to put on us. They wanted to say that any effect at the atomic level, the atom level, would result in a problem for the organism, and ignored all responses. They ignored any feedback, any corrective, any adaptive responses. Okay? So the risk of a double strand break rises linearly. They don't even take into account the probability that the double strand break would lead to cancer and that there's responses that would prevent that from happening. And that there's protective signaling for radiation-activated natural protection. It's a stimulant. These are all comments from various groups that were associated with this low-dose program. This presentation was given in 2008. So it protects against chromosome damage, mutations, neoplastic transformations, high-dose chemical and radiation-induced cancers. One of the interesting things that came out in the DOE low-dose radiation was that if you have somebody that is going to be exposed to radiation later, in other words, maybe somebody you're using radiation treatment, if you give them a low dose a day or so ahead of time, they respond much better to the treatment. They're much more able to accept the treatment without a lot of the side effects. It's sort of a stimulant. It gives you a little tickle that says, okay, I've got my body's going to be ready for this big dose later. Okay? So all of these things that are potential health benefits, we can't really, at least in the United States, ethically test for them on living human beings. Because we assume by regulation that all radiation is dangerous. So if it's a danger, you can't use that on people. Okay? I kind of like the idea of finding new treatments that aren't necessarily drug-related and perhaps actually cure things rather than simply giving you some side effect or some relief. Here's an interesting graph. Mice that were radiated lived longer, even though they were diabetic to begin with. And here's a nice graphic of what the mice looked like. The top is the irradiated mice. The bottom is the non-irradiated mice. Notice one of them is laying upside down. That was one of the ones that didn't last up to 90 weeks. Okay? So, again, that kind of graphical thing says, wait a minute, this stuff may be not as dangerous as we're told. This, again, is the curves that we expect the doses would give, zone of maximum protection. All right. I'm going to stop it here and make sure that I put this down where it's going to be safe and say, questions? Yes.
So all of this has been known by quite a few people, but the real important question is, what progress are we making to convince or to change these LNT-imposed regulations to be more logical?
It's a great question. There is a group that was formed about a year ago called SARI, and I know the group's been formed in the past, but
SARI.
S-A-R-I. Okay, SARI. Scientists for Accurate Radiation Information. They've got a large number of specialists from around the world in various areas that are sharing information and writing responses to things. When the EPA asks for comments on radiation protection rules and the NRC has a request for information, SARI is getting involved. But there's also been a large number of other people outside of that have been pressing the notion. Some of them are people from the low-dose radiation protection program, a low-dose radiation effects program, and has had an effect. On November 17th, the National Academy of Sciences is convening a meeting in Washington to discuss whether or not there's been enough new science since 2006 when they issued their last report to review for a Beer 8. So that, I think is a big step forward, because the notice that they sent out indicated to me that there's people that have been reading the signs and really want to make the change. Now, there's some motivation to that. I kept pointing out that some of the early imposition was funded by the Rockefeller Foundation and notified by their trustees. And of course, you know, it's obvious that Rockefeller money all comes from oil and gas. And that they probably didn't like all those things excited us when we saw a power plant. We shut off the flow of fuel to it. There's no more gas coming out, but there's no more fuel going in. They saw that as lost markets. They saw that as an increase in the supply of energy, which would drive down the price of the other energy fuels. That's my belief, that they recognized that very early on. They recognized it as in the 1930s, when people started figuring out there's a lot of energy inside the atom. There's motivation to apply real science now, because people are figuring out, wait a minute, if there is somebody uses a radiation-enhanced device, an explosive, a dirty bomb, then we may lose access to an entire city, even though we know there's no negative health effects just because of panic. You know, we may lose, we're paying a lot of money, and I know there's people in here that are benefiting from this, but I'll say it right out. We're paying a lot of money to clean up dirt. It's already dirty, and it's always going to be dirty. But, you know, it's kind of radioactive dirt, so we should spend $2 billion a year in Eastern Washington to clean it up. To what level? Where's the real level that says, okay, we're to the point where we're causing damage? You know, when I look at the scenes from Fukushima and I see all this topsoil being scraped and put in plastic bags, and people say, well, what do we do with it now? You know, the real answer is put it back where you found it, because you need soil to grow anything. Yeah, it's going to be a little bit radioactive, but it's not dangerously radioactive. So that's, I think that's a step, is getting the beer, getting people, the right people on the committee. You know, getting people who are, in fact, experts on the health effects of low-dose radiation on the committee, making sure that nobody, you know, what they've done in the past when beer met was that they would come up with the best fit line. Okay, but the best fit line already eliminates what might be the actuality, because they refuse to accept the curve that goes below zero. Any data that goes down there, they throw out. You know, you take all of the things that give you benefit, you take those away. Well, sure, the average now is a negative effect. You just threw away all the positives. Express fear. No change will ever be made. Okay. We need to understand, and we need to be able to be comfortable. Now, some of the people I know are now literally wearing pitch blend or a few other various ores on necklaces around their neck, because they believe that if you go to and you measure what the doses are, you're not being crazy, you actually expose yourself purposely, they're going to radiation spas, and they're showing that, hey, this does have a good effect. You know, I also like to point to, again, anecdotal, you know, kind of samples, but if you ever look at, you know, some of the ANS obituaries, and you realize how long some of the pioneers lived, you know, there's a whole bunch of folks in their 90s, you know, if you look at the list of people who were at CP1, I believe that, if I remember the number correctly, 25 of them lived into their 90s. And they were, you know, handling stuff, and then of course most of them stayed in the nuclear field for a lot more than their career. I don't know if their dose was, but they lived pretty long. You know, there's an awful lot. Edward Teller, I think, lives to be 95 years old. Yeah, Glenn Seaborg was in his 90s. Yes.
So in modern power plant operations, dose is a currency the same way as money is in terms of an outage. you know, there's an assigned dose to different maintenance applications. I'm sure you have the same thing that you do with their program. And that leads us to a situation where we're making decisions to save dose on, say, making a certain plant modification, to do it right versus to do it halfway and finishing off the next outage. So can we, or how do we, tie total safety of the plant operations so that we're properly accounting for the true risk of this lower dose currency or this dose allocation for an outage?
It's an important point. If people are very concerned about real safety, not pretend safety, they're very concerned about real economics, you know, there are things that we have done to ourselves. You know, I point to Davis Bessie as an example of what can happen when you're really worried about your man-rem budget. You know, you don't do your inspections as thoroughly as you should because you want to save a few millirem. You want to, you don't put as many people in, you don't do things as carefully, or on the flip side, you put people at physical risk because you're afraid of getting any skin contamination. You know, in an environment where it's already hot, you put them in double anti-seize boots and skin and you know, gloves and all that stuff, and you make it so they can't crawl down a ladder safely. I mean, I think you wrote an article about the kind of absurd level where the access to an area was difficult at best, and then when you did it in anti-seize, you had a big risk of falling down the ladder. Again, to avoid a small risk of skin contamination, which the right answer to skin contamination is wash your hands, and wash them again if you need to. And if you need to, you know, use some different soap. I had a senior chief that worked for me, or I guess I worked for him. He was older than me, was teaching me, but I outranked him because I was an officer. But we had a situation in the Navy where there had been a couple of instances of skin contamination, and some admiral came out with what I think is one of the most stupid communication you do, is the next person that does this will be fired. You know, what's the first thing you do if you're a sailor? Well, I ain't going to tell everybody if I do it, because I don't want to get fired. You know. So, senior chief Tess came in one day and says, well, you know, I read this missive and I got a solution. Back then, our minimum detectable level was 100 counts per minute. And he said, so if I get, and I put my hand under the frisker, and I get 200 counts per minute, that's skin contamination, isn't it? 100 counts per minute on each hand. Less than 100. All right. So, you know, and in many cases, quite honest, dilution is a solution to pollution. Okay? It really is. If you want to get to where nobody gets hurt, you just dilute the material.
Especially for rats.
Well, it is. It works very well. And if you take a radioactive isotope of a metal and you mix that with non-radioactive isotope of the same metal, physically you can get it. So you can't get a dangerous dose because you spread it out.
And the solution to pollution is dilution.
Right. Well, that's exactly what I was trying to. You know, get people to remember that.
Okay.
Logic.
Anything else? Your story of the fear factor really is timely right now with the whole Ebola thing, because really we have what, a handful of cases in the United States?
Yeah, population of 330 million people, and we've got three people.
And 30,000 people die each year from influenza. So. And the doctors are having trouble getting people to have their flu shots because they're afraid that they're going to get some dosage that's going to screw them up. I thought maybe you were going to talk, though, today about what's in the news with the whole thing in Germany. I don't know, did you see there's a story here? I didn't get a date on it, but it talks about how you are an expert and It says 59, German power grid reaches 59% renewable energy peak, power prices plummet, and the grid does not explode. Okay? And the headline for it was, Clean Technica refutes sales pitch of nuclear salesman Rod Adams. Have you seen this?
No.
From Nuclear News. So basically what they're saying is renewable energy growth is greater than the nuclear decline in Germany, according to this story.
Let's hear it from the nuclear salesman, Rod Adams.
Thank you all for having me.